Hello. Hello. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Hi, I'm Rick Hess, Director of Education Policy Studies here at the American Enterprise Institute. It's my honor to introduce a couple of remarkable panels of just inspirational leaders in the work of education to talk about some of the thorniest challenges that confront schools and schooling and communities, and to a lesser degree, education policy as we think about America in 2017. The topic for today is race, social justice, and school reform. I've been privileged in pulling together today's panels. We're building on a remarkable conversation we just had for the better part of today with about two dozen educational thinkers and leaders and activists from across the country. I've been able to do this work in partnership with the NewSchools Venture Fund. NewSchools CEO Stacy Childress will be up here a bit later. And also with the education journal Education Next, of which I have the privilege of being an executive editor. But between NewSchools and EdNext and AEI, we're just delighted to be able to present these conversations this afternoon. For those of you here with us today, and the couple thousand I understand who are joining us via live stream, terrific to have all of you with us. Pleased to hear that, and hope and confident that we're going to have a conversation that'll be well worth your time. Look, it's real simple. America has a lot of challenges. Our political debate has grown remarkably polarized. We have real difficulties talking about important issues in ways that I think are respectful, are constructive, advance our ability to listen to each other or disagree like the kinds of people and the kinds of citizens that we want to be. This is important in any walk of life. It's critical in any area of policy and activity. I can't think of anywhere where it matters more than in education. Education is about trying to raise the kinds of citizens we want to have join us. It is about the values we want to impart to our children. It is about the kind of nation and the kind of communities we want to create. We're going to disagree about this stuff because these are huge issues, and we come at them with different values and different lenses and different experiences. But for me, one of the critical challenges is, can we deal with these disagreements in ways that are worthy of ourselves, of the work, of the children that we're trying to serve, and of the country that we inhabit? I think we have sometimes fallen short, that we've too often fallen short. But part of the challenge is, can we do better going forward? I think we can. I think you're going to hear from a bunch of leaders who show that we can, who are committed to doing so. And part of the conversation is not only about these issues, these important disagreements about questions like race and social justice and how they apply to school reform, but also how do we tackle these disagreements in healthy and constructive ways. We're going to bring two panels up here. The first is going to be hosted by my colleague, Gerard Robinson. The second, as I mentioned, by NewSchools CEO Stacy Childress. Each is going to have a panel conversation followed by an opportunity for audience Q&A. Before I turn it over to Gerard, just a couple final things. One, please turn off any cell phones or at least put them on silent. Two, if you want to follow along on Twitter, the hashtag is Race in Ed Reform. That's Race in Ed Reform. And during Q&A, we're going to take questions from Twitter as well as in the audience. So feel free to contribute your questions that way. In addition to the live stream, the video is going to be posted after our conclusion today, so you'll be able to find it on the AEI website. And finally, as we turn it over, let me just ask, as I am wholly confident we will, that the audience is engaged with the same degree of civility and respect that I think you're going to see demonstrated by the folks who have been kind enough to join us today. With that, Gerard, let me turn it over to you and the panel.
All right. Hello, everyone. While I can still say this, let me say Happy New Year. A number of you, this is your first time to AEI, so welcome to our new digs. And I can't think of a better topic to discuss, particularly given the work and leadership that Rick has led at AEI for 14 years on education, than to look at race, social justice, and school reform. Now, 7 months ago, this conversation would have probably taken a different turn if the election would have been different. And now with a different election, some people say it will turn in a different way. Maybe it has or maybe it hasn't. Now remember, we had a black president, first time in American history, it turned one way. Now we have a different president, turns a different way. And so what we've decided to do is to assemble a group of people to have a conversation about the subject, and all of them bring to this conversation professional, personal histories, and we just walked away from very good dialogue. So let me introduce them, and then we will go straight into questions. I'm no order of introduction in terms of who I'll go to first. First, we have Alicia Beard, who is the president of TFA. She was not only a core member, but actively involved in making sure that school reform means something real to all Americans. We have Dr. Howard Fuller, who wears multiple hats. Many of you know him as one of the founders of BAO, but he's also the director of the Institute for the Transformation of Learning at Marquette. We have Robert Pondicio, who's with the Thomas Fordham Institute here in DC. And we have Nina Reese, who is the president of the National Alliance for Public Charter Schools. One interesting thing I want to say about each person to kind of put some humor in the room, just to put this in context. Alicia, what most of you probably do not know, still holds a record for scoring in high school when she was playing basketball. So she's still proud of that. It's something that she can have. For Dr. Fuller, many of you know him as a social justice guy, but most of you don't know that he's also a DJ. Now, he doesn't have a cool name, he just goes as Howard. But he's a really good DJ, and so he can cover different genres, so we'll leave it there. We've got Robert. Most people don't know that Robert earned his undergraduate degree when he was 39 years old. And so he is actually the new norm in higher education, because most students today who are enrolled in college are over the age of 25, are working, and aren't throwing Frisbees on campus. So he's part of that movement. And Nina Reese, one of her many pleasures in life is listening to cover bands for Journey.
We're attending Journey.
Yeah, the band out of San Francisco, you know, Don't Stop Believing. So as we're talking about believing, let's switch off to our first question about race, social justice, and school reform. So over the past 12 months, race and social justice has gotten a lot of attention for a lot of different reasons. From your perspective, do you think it's gotten better or worse? And we'll start with Dr. Fuller and kind of move from there.
What was the question? No. I don't know, Gerard, man. Like, the way I look at the world is, if you're poor, and you know whatever race, but if you're poor and you're a poor person of color, black people who I spend my time thinking about, ain't nothing changed, man, other than the conditions of their lives are worse. And so for me, it's like getting up every day understanding that no matter who's in the White House, the people I care about gonna have to fight. And it's just the issue of what is the fight gonna be? What's the nature of the fight? How deep is the fight gonna have to be? But I'm just a person who tries to understand. I'm fundamentally a pessimist about, you know, where we are and all that. But I'm not a pessimist to the point that I'm not gonna get up every day and try to make change. And so since I believe, for example, that racism in America is permanent, as Derek Bell talked about in Faces at the Bottom of the Well. But I also understand that even if something that I believe is an injustice, I don't see a pathway to making real change. I still have to get up and fight every day, because if I don't, I'm co-signing on the injustice. And so, I mean, that's sort of how I see it.
Robert, what do you think?
I have a different take on ed reform in general. I mean, I guess I should out myself and say that the lens through which I view all of our work is always going to be the classroom lens. The reason I didn't graduate from college until 39 is because, frankly, I didn't need to. I wanted to join the New York City Teaching Fellows, and I couldn't do it unless I had a degree. So I joined the fellows. I taught in the South Bronx for 5 years. Never quite went back to my previous life. But my role in rooms like this, as it were, has always been to evangelize on behalf of what kids actually do in the classroom all day. In other words, we tend to talk about charters, choice, data, teacher quality, and I'm always saying, yeah, that's great. Now can we talk about curriculum, instruction, education practice? So that doesn't change, honestly. My frustration, and it's a mild frustration, but it is a frustration nonetheless, is that sometimes these conversations take us further away from that conversation. In no way do I want to say anything that diminishes the importance of race, of social justice, but I always come back to first cases, which is if we're not talking about what kids, especially low-income kids of color like every child I've ever taught is, then we are missing something profound. So while I don't want to characterize this conversation as a diversion or of secondary importance, it's critical, but I'm always going to be that guy who says, yes, 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 now let's talk about what kids do in school all day, because this is how we're going to solve that problem.
What's your take, Nina?
So your question was whether it's gotten better or worse, and I would say it's always been a discussion in our movement. When I first got introduced to this movement through Dr. Fuller and others, this has always been something that a lot of individuals in our movement have embraced. A good portion of the folks who support charter schools are in it for the social justice purpose, and a good portion, the majority of the students attending charter schools are minorities and low-income students. So this has always been an issue that we've talked about. But I would say that in recent years, we've gotten far more attention on the topic because of social media and some of the other issues in the national news. And so there's definitely a greater sense of awareness about the need to discuss these issues in the racial context. And to some extent, those who are involved in our movement are also asking themselves, is education now enough? Is the fact that we're doing so much to get our students to graduate high school and go on to college, is that really setting them off and putting them in a better place if there are all these other issues that are still percolating around?
Okay. So what do you think?
Elisa. I think I maybe have a slightly different take. I don't think we've always centered on the work in terms of race, justice, and social reform in its truest form. And I think we define the problem differently. And that then dictates how you think about what's causing the problem and then how you approach solving it. So if you accept that talent is distributed equally across lines of race and class, and if you also accept the fact that, you know, where you happen to be born today dictates your life opportunities, then you also understand that this issue disproportionately impacts children growing up in low-income communities and children of color, then I would argue you have to understand the role of race, class, and privilege in order to responsibly be an intervention that's trying to be helpful in partnering with the communities that we say we care about. And so I would make two points about that. I mean, the first on why race, class, and privilege matters is first, I think it's irresponsible to not think about it that way, because when we look at just evidence and data, and we can look at lots of folks that have studied this and the impact of bias in classrooms and how that impacts children of color, we just can't deny that this deeply matters. And then in a very practical sense, this is what our kids are up against every day. I taught first grade, and I had a colleague next door, who would say, at first graders, that she believed we were raising the future prison mates of the state of Arizona. And that is not talk that's like, oh my gosh, that is shocking that she said that. That is the normalized talk that you hear and what people expect of our kids. And Bush even said, you know, the soft bigotry of low expectations. So this is not something that's shocking. Like, of course it deeply matters. And understanding our role in that, I think, it's hugely important. And the second thing I would say is I don't think we've always talked about the systemic nature of the problem. And I'm a believer that education is transformational for children. And that's why I do the work that I have done my whole professional life. But I also think that we have to understand all the inequities facing our kids, and that we have to tend to the fact that our kids live in food deserts and they don't have access to nutrition or healthcare, and that all these things come together, and that there are merits to the folks taking on these various issues that impact our kids. And so I think over the last year, these conversations have become more in the forefront. And I think some people call it distracting. Some people think it's unfocused. And I think there is a way for us to deeply understand a focus on educational excellence and equity, and understanding that simultaneous to that, you need all these interventions to actually make progress.
One of the tough things about race and ideology is honesty and perception. And so, Robert, hearing your story, if I'm in the audience, I'm looking at you, good-looking white guy, comes from a lot of money, he's already been well. Wait a minute, 39? You didn't have a college degree? How do perceptions fall into how we talk about race and ideology in the U.S.? Because often it's Hispanic, black, but there are white dynamics as well.
I'm going to answer the question I think you asked, or maybe the question I wish you asked. better way to put it. One of the issues I think that the last year and this conversation about race and social justice has surfaced for me, and I think we've all become aware of this now, given the results of the 2016 election. I entered this work because I care deeply about New York City and the South Bronx. I've been involved in that community for quite a number of years. So I brought a race and class lens, as it were, to my interest in becoming a teacher. I'm not sure where this became a race-based movement, however. And I think about the way we talk about it, or at least we have in the last 10 or 15 years. We talk about achievement gaps, and there are good political reasons for it that we needn't unpack, but we all know. One of the lessons I think of the last year has been, and look, you know, I'm not J.D. Vance. My experience was, you know, not hillbilly elegy. My parents were blue collar, but you know, things worked out for me, so that validates the idea of privilege without a doubt. I'm just curious as to where ed reform became a predominantly race-based initiative, if it is that. Surely there are a lot of kids. In the industrial Midwest, et cetera, who are white, who are low income, who are downwardly mobile, their schools aren't very good either. So I think we risk losing something as a movement if we don't refocus on education writ large. And again, at the risk of repeating myself, that's one of the reasons I focus on what happens in the classroom, because that does or should cut across all of these lines.
So Nina, you're one of the few people in the room who's had a chance to work in charter schools, also support the private school movement, early childhood. So you've seen conversations of race, ideology take place in different sectors. From your experience, how should we be thinking 2017 moving ahead about this issue?
Well, just to Robert's point, I mean, there's a real reason why this issue ended up becoming more about race and class and centered in inner cities. And from a political standpoint, that's where the need is greatest, where the sense of urgency is the greatest. I would argue that it is actually quite hard to expand charter schools in a lot of rural communities because there is no political base of support for those types of changes. So there are reasons why this became what it became. And so to some extent, the resistance in some communities stems from the fact that these free market ideas are being tested in communities that needed them the most. And people are now noticing maybe this is not taking us as far as we want to go, as fast as we want to go. So these are really real issues that we have to grapple with. In terms of where we go from here, look, I think we've made huge progress, especially in the charter school space. We now have a little over 6,700 charter schools, a little over 3 million students in charter schools in 43 states and in Washington, D.C. And I do think if you want to continue to grow and create a greater base of political support, from an advocacy standpoint, you do need to bring middle-income and rural communities along, because the sheer reality is if your program is only going to benefit the poor, there's going to be a cap on how much money you can bring in and how much support you can garner. And you can't constantly go to constituents or members who don't have any charter schools in their districts and ask them to support the growth of charter schools in districts that they don't represent. And we saw that full well in states like Massachusetts. So I do think if this is something that the movement is interested in, we do need to double down on the effort. We definitely have the evidence that it works, but it has to be done right. And to do it right, you do need funding, whether it's public sources of funding, philanthropic sources of funding. And the more you create charter schools, like in Arizona, for instance, where there are charter schools everywhere, you know, the base, the political base of support for charters in that state is extremely strong because you have everyone who knows someone who's attending a charter school if they don't have someone in a charter school. But the road that Arizona took to get there was a pretty bumpy road. I don't know that a lot of reformers right now would point to Arizona as a state that they would want to, whose law they would want to put in place, because they did take a lot of chances in the initial few years.
Some would refer to as a wild, wild west yes. of school reform.
But so they're this doing is very well right now. So
yes.
Yeah. And they have broad political support.
Exactly.
So this is for Dr. Fuller. So amongst other things, he was superintendent of schools in Milwaukee, which became home to one of the few cities with both a charter voucher. You had long desegregation efforts, busing and otherwise. Milwaukee is a microcosm for what American school reform is going through today. Mm. Back in the early 90s, ideology was important. And you know about ideology in ways many of us do not. What role did ideology, class, and race play in Milwaukee when you had urban Democrats, suburban Republicans, and people in the middle?
Okay, so the thing that most people just forget is that a lot of things would not have happened had it not been for Polly Williams. And Polly Williams was a black Democrat with courage. And Polly and I actually went to high school together. And the thing I keep telling people is that when we push for vouchers in Milwaukee, I'll just speak for myself, I had never heard of capitalism and freedom. I didn't like read Milton Friedman and be bamboozled. I actually didn't know that there was such a book. And the way that we got to vouchers, I know this doesn't fit people's narrative, was that our struggle started out trying to make sure that low income and working class, really poor black children, were being educated by the Milwaukee public school system. And when we went to the superintendent, and this dude said basically, you know, that they weren't capable of doing it, whatever he said, we then said, well, look, if y'all are not going to do it, then we want to create our own separate school district, you know, so that we'll take it on. And then we actually got to vote through the legislature, through the assembly, to create a separate school district. And Derrick Bell came to make the constitutional argument for it. And then it was defeated in the Senate. I think it passed in the assembly because they knew it was going to be defeated in the Senate. And then since the district wasn't going to educate our kids, you wouldn't give us our own district. For us, logically, the next point was let us out of here. Give us a way to get out of here. Give us a way then to create our own thing. That's how we came to vouchers. And it was nothing about free market ideology. I hate to tell people that. I hadn't even heard of this stuff, man. I was like,
not at this place. It's okay to say it here.
Yeah, right. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, man, freedom. You know what I'm saying? I mean, like, if you're not gonna educate us, you're not gonna let us do it, then give us instruments that will let us out of it. And what most people don't realize is that the then school superintendent, Bob Peterkin, and his deputy, Dr. Deborah McGriff, had actually worked with the community to create a choice plan. And so the district was actually working with us, and then the teachers union put in poison pill stuff that the community couldn't accept. That then led to Polly putting together what became the Milwaukee Parental Choice Program. And for all the people in here, this passed through a Democratic control legislature, because both the Assembly and the Senate was controlled by Democrats. The only reason why it ultimately became law was because the governor that I was working for, a Democrat, got defeated. Because had Tony been the governor, there never would have been a Milwaukee Parental Choice Program, because he would have vetoed it. Mm. But Tommy Thompson, who was a Republican, became the governor, and he signed it. So I'm telling you all of that because a lot of people running around talking don't know jack about what actually happened, and ascribing all kinds of motivations and stuff that really was not the case. And so what I would say in closing on this, Gerard, is that I think it was, for those of us who fought for it, it was not driven by ideology, mm-hmm. as much as it was driven by the simple thing that we wanted our kids to be educated. And that if the existing structure could not do it, would not do it, then we needed other mechanisms. Now, there were people, clearly, who did have an ideological perspective, mm-hmm. not just a free market perspective, but also this is a way to kill unions.
Sure.
So that the unholy alliance, or I forgot, Jason, what Polly called it, or the unholy coalition or something, involved a lot of different people with different perspectives, right? Mm-hmm. Understanding Derrick Bell's interest convergence theory. This was a primary example of how that occurred. Okay. So there were people in the coalition that ultimately created the voucher mm-hmm. bill that were in it for very different reasons. And there were always people in there saying, I don't really believe that this should just be for poor people. I believe it ought to be universal. But right now, all we can do is get it for poor people. And I was always in there saying, hey, man, the day that y'all try to take it from poor people, I'm going to just be a lone Negro that y'all can run over. But I'm going to be standing there saying no, because I didn't get in this for all y'all who already got money to get more money. So there were always these ideological differences, because there were people who came at it with a very strict ideology, but there were those of us who were in it, as I said, just to try to make sure that kids could get educated.
So, Lisa, you've been in the classroom. We know at the end of the day, all of us in here, many are reformers, policymakers, and otherwise, teachers are the one who deliver education to kids. And we know the teaching force today looks very different than the majority of the student population today. What role has TFA played in diversifying the teaching community? And what role, because you guys have done some great things, what role particularly have you guys played on the discussion about race and social justice?
Yeah. As a reminder for folks that don't know, so, you know, 50% of the kids in public schools today, over 50% are kids of color, and about 7% are Latino, and about 8% are African American in terms of the teachers that are actually teaching kids across America. So one thing to note, over 26 years, what we have learned is that actually, no matter your background, no matter the color of your skin, you can successfully teach with kids growing up in low-income communities. That's not the dictator of success in the classroom, and that is our analysis based on all that we've learned. However, we do know that it does matter for kids to see themselves in other adults who look like them. And we think that that's grossly important. To today, 2% of all teachers are black men. And we think that that is a problem given, you know, that it's crucially important for young black men to see themselves in those that hold knowledge and are revered in schools as their teachers and the administrators in schools. And so we have focused on this because we think it's really important. And we, again, work in predominantly low-income communities and predominantly schools that are low-income community. And we believe that there should be a meaningful number of, you know, folks in the work who are influencing and shaping this work who actually have faced the issues of inequity. So today, 50% of our core members are people of color, are teachers, and that is something that we are proud of and think that is really important. I also will say that being said, we also do really believe that it is critical to have a diverse coalition that truly does represent America with a shared set of values all in on this work for educational equity. I deeply believe that if we cannot reach every dinner table in America that's talking about this conversation, has real conviction about the potential of our children and what's possible, we will never make sustained transformational change with our communities. And so those two things, I think, are really important to hold constant as we think about systems change and we think about real change over time.
Okay. For those of you who are watching, you can join at slido.com, hashtag AEI event, and feel free to send me a question. I have a couple that are here already. So one thing that's also bubbled to the surface in this conversation is politics and maybe partisanship. And Robert, you bring up a very good point about when did this just become about one set of kids? Here's a question, and really anyone can jump in. When did social justice become a progressive thing? And is there a role for conservatives in the social justice conversation?
Yes. I think that's, and I don't want to present myself as a spokesperson for any particular ideology, but as some of you may know, I wrote a piece last year that seemed to have sparked a conversation about this. Because I think a lot of folks, and frankly, a lot of people I spoke to on, once a reporter, always a reporter. Unlike a lot of other people who write about this, I pick up the phone, I talk to people, I take down what they say. So it wasn't representing necessarily, at least not completely my point of view, but just people I know in this movement on the right had pronounced themselves increasingly uncomfortable. I think the analogy I used in the piece was like the old thing about the pot coming to a slow boil with a frog inside of it, and suddenly you wake up and like, wow, this is feeling really uncomfortable for me. So I'm not sure when it happened, but it happened. So suddenly those of us on the political right found ourselves just, I don't want to say put off, because that's not right, but just saying, hey, to my point, can we talk about schools? Can we talk about policies for schools, as opposed to some of these other issues that, however important, take us further and further from, I've said for years that one of the things I find unusual about the ed reform movement, if it's a movement, is how incurious we are. We just lose interest at the classroom door, which is odd. As an educator, that's pretty much all I care about. So there were two concerns that I had. One was that we were moving further and further away as ed reformers from focusing on what I think matters, which is what kids do all day. And then there was, frankly, just the realpolitik, as it were, the political reality of, and this has gotten worse or better, depending on your perspective, in the last couple of months. We have a very red country. We have, 30 states that have red legislatures, red governors. It just didn't make sense to me that we were going to lead with a social justice conversation while trying to expand the charter movement in those states. I mean, this is not to suggest that these are not important conversations, and we all come to this work for different reasons, but it just didn't make sense to me that you were going to talk about the social justice imperatives of charters and choice and whatnot to legislators in Oklahoma, in Kansas, and whatnot. And that still doesn't make sense to me.
Anyone else want to weigh in?
I mean, sure. So when you center on education as the ability to be transformational for kids, and especially kids growing up in low-income communities, kids of color, and you are working for educational excellence and equity, I think it is intellectually dishonest to not understand, given like lots of information and learnings we have from the last 26 years, to say that it is unfocused or social justice-y to care about these other things. So first of all, I don't even see the world in politics. I know everything is about politics, but I focus on what is it going to take? What have we learned about expanding educational opportunities and access for children growing up in low-income communities? And sometimes those positions are going to be, appease the right, and sometimes they're going to appease the left. But we're not making decisions based on trying to appease anybody. It's on what we actually really believe matters for moving the needle on this stuff. So, when we say we have a position on DACA, which means, kids who have come here as children and have and deserve access to education and should get jobs and should be able to go to schools and live a full life because they didn't choose to come here as kids. Their parents made that choice. And we just think that's within our lane, but that becomes political. We just think I just think we've learned too much to try to say it's if only this, because we also do know if only this, it's not gonna get us where we need to go because the complexity is too big and there's too much going on with our kids. They're up against so much. And so I just think we're not being honest about what it's going to take to really move the needle. I think if we want to continue to have incremental change and do work on the margins, we just, you know, don't acknowledge these other things that I just think are so critical and important. And I think part of maturing, and as if we are honest about learning and understanding, you know, all these interventions really do matter.
My version of being honest about things is to say that for 40 years, 17-year-old NAEP in this country looks like a dead man's EKG. It just isn't moving. Okay, so yes, these things matter, and I don't mean to make light of it. I want my kids, my 17-year-olds, to be able to read the damn legislation. You know, and that's the problem. Like, you know, it's wonderful to sit in panels like this and talk about things like this, but we are not educationally sophisticated enough, or we're not. That's imprecise. I wish as a profession that our level of play in the classroom was to the point that we could have these conversations. We're just not very good at what we do. And until we fix that problem, and again, I want to be careful here. I don't want to suggest those things are unimportant, but my focus is the classroom. And I don't want to say those things are a distraction. But I don't see the how you connect the, well, that's wrong too. Education takes place within a context. I guess I can't
Robert,
say any better than
that. When a kid shows up hungry every day, it does matter. It doesn't mean you lower their expectations, but if we're just ignoring that and have...
But at what point, ed reformers, does this become the next version of fixed poverty first? And we've spent 20 years pushing against that.
No one is suggesting that. I mean, that's no one is suggesting that.
Sure. No, go ahead. Nita?
Well, I would just say it depends on the community that you're in. The charter school movement is extremely diverse, and I think we are quick to treat ourselves as a movement that's united when the fabric of our movement was very decentralized from the beginning, and these conversations actually do need to start happening. So if there is a case to be made for the things that Elisa talks about, I do think you need to bring the other side that you're trying to convince to the table and have the kind of discussion that you guys hosted today first, because just starting to talk about it on social media or through a blog or attacking someone for holding views that they may or may not realize that they have is really not the right place to start.
Let me pivot. So. No, someone else? Okay. Let me pivot to this question. It's online, and I think it's pertinent to what we just discussed. What are your thoughts about online public schooling? And I raise that in the context of there's some lawmakers who voted against legislation that we had in Virginia in 2010 because they said it would actually lead to kids segregating more, not interacting enough, and therefore exacerbating the problem possibly of race and social justice. Do you buy that or not? Can technology, online learning play a role in advancing reform, social justice, or actually make it worse? Dr. Fuller?
It can do both. I mean, it depends on what it is. I mean, see, I don't have an ideological position against online learning. I have a position against people who are profiting off our kids and our kids ain't learning nothing. Mm-hmm. I got a problem with that. I mean, so a lot of these positions that people take, to me, I have problems with it because I'm asking, like, what is the result? So why would you be against people learning online as a principle, mm-hmm. as opposed to I'm against an online operation that is clearly not educating kids. People are ripping people off, but having been a superintendent, man, people rip people off in the traditional system. I mean, and people who talk to me about I'm against private entities and I'm for public entities, you're talking to a black person who understands that we've been oppressed by private entities and public entities. And so don't talk to me about things just, you know, took this hard line position without telling me the specifics of the situation. Because it's like every time I hear people say, poor kids only need one option. I'm like, hey, do you remember slavery? Do you remember like when black people came out of slavery, understanding the connection between freedom and education? Who understood instinctively that in order for this freedom to be realized so that we can actually be liberated, we need an education. And so we fought for that, right? We, black people are the ones, for example, who were critical to the development of public education in the South. And then when the Missouri Compromise took place and the white people reinstalled the white people that ostensibly the Civil War was fought to get out of power, what happened to us? What happened to us was they took the money out of the schools that we had created and created white schools and told us we couldn't go to them. And so then we not only had to pay taxes for schools we couldn't go to, we then had to tax ourselves to create our own schools. So if you understand history in that way, as I try to understand it, then you're always cautious when people start telling you that this is the only way that you can operate, you can't do online, you can only do this. I just don't buy that. But at the same time, I'm not going to just universally say I support all of this without any regard to what impact it is actually having on kids.
Sure.
Because at some point, you do have to come back and ask that question.
Yes.
And you also, I think, have to make a distinction between schools and financial mechanisms that are used to get people to a school.
Sure.
And so people are criticizing the mechanism. Like all of y'all who got money, you know, who oppose giving poor people money so that they can have choices like you do, the hypocrisy in America on this issue is astounding. And so I'm just saying, Gerard, to me at a certain point, man, the argument always is whatever it is I'm for, how does that empower a people who have no power? Mm-hmm. Who have no real capacity in this country? What can I do to change the trajectory of their lives?
Sure.
Yeah. And okay. So I'm, yeah. Whatever.
I'll just add that I have a very simplistic view of this, frankly, which is, as far as I can tell, the public's interest is in a well-educated citizenry, period, full stop. Under whose roof, on whose nickel? I'm not saying those things are not concerns, but they are secondary concerns.
Yeah, but I mean, to me, at some point, you have to make a distinction between public education and the system that delivers
sure.
it. Because the concept of the public being educated means that there's a number of different systems that can be developed to make that happen.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we start talking about these things, people criticize, oh, you're against public education. No, I'm against some of the delivery systems that we have created.
Amen.
And since they were not created by God, we actually could change them. We actually could come up with some different delivery systems. And does that make me like a horrible person who's probably, but I'm saying if you can conceptualize this distinction between public education and the system that delivers it,
mm-hmm.
it opens up the possibility, if we actually care about kids, it opens up the possibility for creating a more dynamic way to deliver on the promise of public education.
It doesn't make you a horrible person, it should make you education secretary.
It's not that controversial because the system that was created was not created to educate every kid, and what we need to educate kids for today in the 21st century in a global economy is fundamentally different. And so it gets confusing on what we're trying to protect when we just realize like the system was not built to do what we need it to do today for every kid in America. And so let's just accept that, understand like there's lots of great things to learn from that are happening, and there's lots of new innovations that we need to embrace as we go forward.
As you see, we have a very healthy dialogue taking place. I'm going to open it up to the audience. What I'm going to do is we've got people with microphones. We've got two rules here at AEI. Number one, just state your name and affiliation. And number two, ask a question, not give a speech. We've got a lot of people in the room, and I'm sure we have a number of questions. So I'm going to start on this side. Just raise your hand, and we will come to you. Okay, none on this side. I feel like an auctioneer. Over here, we've got one in the back. Mike's coming to you.
Hi, my name is Chandy Wagner. I'm with the National School Boards Association. I'm curious what happened to integration as a school reform. In the 70s and 80s, we saw the greatest decrease in the achievement gap. There's a lot of research that shows both socioeconomic and racial segregation. Integration is really important for students, but we spent a lot of time talking about accountability and school structures. how do we integrate kids? And because we see that in the classroom, as you mentioned previously, what happens in the classroom with kids matters.
One of our colleagues, Richard Kallenberg, talks a great deal about that along with Gary Orfield. Who wants to take that?
White people moved. I mean, what are y'all talking about? What happened is all the people who talk about integration moved to the suburbs so that they didn't have to be integrated, but then they can pontificate about integration to those of us who still live in the city.
Yep.
That's what happened. I mean, look, just...
So we got to solve that problem.
No. Listen, in Derek Bell's book, Shades of Brown, Judge Robert Carter, who had the responsibility to put the social science literature before the court, all the people who run around talking about the Brown decision who ain't never read it, if you look at footnote 11 in the Brown decision, that's where all of the social science literature is that led to them coming up with this thing about, you know, if it's all black, by definition, it's inferior. Judge Robert Carter, who had the responsibility to put that information before the court, in Derek Bell's book, said that if you were to ask me, is integration ultimately the solution for America, I would say yes. But he said, you know what, the reality of it is, we're gonna have to figure out how to educate poor black children who are living in all black communities for the foreseeable future. And the reason why, it's because a lot of the people who believe in integration abandon the places where you could have now have integration. And I'm not mad at it because I've never been an integrationist, right? I believe that if people want to live in integrated circumstances, they should. But I've never bought into the notion that because something is all black, by definition, it is inferior. I've always had a problem with the Brown decision because of that.
Got a question in the back.
I think you already anticipated where I was going on Mike Webb. I'm running for a school board over in Arlington. My godfather was the president of the HBCUs, Bill Gray. And so my question is should we shift our focus from integration and diversity to just improving schools? We've got a school in Arlington that is like, I guess like 98% diverse, but it's failing in academics. So I think that maybe we should shift the focus towards education. I just want to get your thoughts on that.
Anyone on the panel? Nina?
Well, we agree, of course. I mean, but going back to the previous question, there is a coalition now that's encouraging the creation of diverse charter schools, for instance. And we certainly think all things being equal, if you could create charter schools that can draw students from both, you know, African-American and white communities and socioeconomically diverse communities, it is better for the school as a whole. But from a public policy standpoint, I do think you need to put certain things in place to encourage the creation of these schools in the right neighborhoods. And I don't know that our policies right now are designed to necessarily encourage those things in every community. But ultimately, our focus ought to be on achievement first. I think when you put integration first, you could spend a lot of money on busing and a whole host of things that have happened in other communities and not necessarily get to your end goal very quickly.
I mean, one thing I would say is having a culturally affirming place where children are valued and feel like their assets are recognized and validated and celebrated, while having high academic achievement are not an either-or proposition. They're actually one and the same and can be one and the same, although people think that you're either, you know, care about diversity or you care about academics. And I would say that you have to really care about both and that there's a way for us to do both, and we see proof of that across the country.
And one thing to add on, it's worth noting that the Hispanic families in Southern California in the 30s and the 40s were some of the first ones pushing to actually integrate schools where they were at one point considered not white and then white, another story. We often forget that they played a role in that as well. Question on this side of the room. Question in the middle.
Hello, my name is Mariama Orange, and I have a question for Dr. Fuller. I was wondering if you could talk more about the distinction between public education and the institutions that deliver it, or the systems of delivery, because at this point I'm finding it hard to understand, since public education is a product of those systems.
I guess I see it the opposite way, and this is actually something I learned from Ted Sizer, whom some people in this room may remember, who was critical to the Coalition of Essential Schools. And so Ted W. Meyer and Dennis Lick and I were Brown fellows, and we spent 2 years just going around the country arguing and visiting schools. And the one thing that Ted taught me was, what is it that actually constitutes a public entity? And his argument was that the notion of public education is an idea. It's we want the public to be educated, right? So then the question was, what is the best way to do that? And so we created a certain delivery system to make sure that that could happen. And the only point I was trying to make is, if I have an issue with the delivery system, it doesn't mean I'm not a supporter of public education. So I'm sitting there saying, for example, if you have a school that's on this corner that's run by the school board, there's a school on this corner run by a church, they're serving the same kids. For whatever reason, if the people over here are able to educate these kids and the people over there are not, to me, it's in the public's interest to try to figure out, how do we get the kids over to a place that does actually educate the kids? Because in my mind, there's another public institution waiting for them if we don't figure out how to educate them, and it's called prison. And so what I'm trying to do is not be committed to an institutional arrangement, because I think the moment you become committed to an institutional arrangement, charter schools or any of that, you're on the way to become a protector of the status quo.
Yes.
And so that what you always have to be committed to is purpose, not to the institutional arrangement to get to purpose. And so that if the purpose is educating the public, let's explore a variety of different institutional arrangements to make good on that promise. Does that but see, if you equate public education with the system that delivers it, then what you're trying to say to me is, if I criticize it, I'm criticizing public education. I'm saying, no, I'm criticizing the delivery system that has been constructed to educate the public.
Anyone else want to weigh in? Another part before we get to the next question in the back, we talked about white people leaving. We also have to talk about the class aspect. We talk about white flight, but there was also the black exodus, and that was the black middle class who also left inner cities to go to suburbans. That's another factor to look at as well. Question right here.
Gina Mahoney, I'm a consultant. To what extent do you think the increase in these conversations, which have certainly intensified over the past couple of years, is a reflection of what's happening externally? So the President Obama's election, Ferguson, and a number of those things. That's one thing I think that's missing. That's when I felt it, particularly in the charter movement. We said we were educating a lot of these kids in these communities, and their communities are going through riots and protests. And I think a lot of us reflected, like, what's our role here?
I mean, because with those, Ferguson, for example, and the many others that have occurred, it's not an abstract thing. It's like real children, and for us, our core members and alumni are in those schools actually teaching these kids. So it's our kids are being impacted by this. So Black Lives Matter isn't a separate thing. It's like what's on our kids' minds. And you don't enter any of these schools without kids feeling fearful and asking really deep, deep questions that they shouldn't be worried about and asking, but they are, because they are watching the news and they are seeing, wait, because I'm a Black boy, does that mean, and the translation of all that. So it's not like it's not like we want to talk about this, like this is the agenda, let's go talk about this, this is what we want to push. It's just reality. It is what is happening in children's lives every day. And so there's no way to divorce yourself from the conversation or, you know, the reality of it. And so, yeah, it's on the forefront, but somehow that's seen as a separate thing that isn't impacting children in classrooms every single day. I was in a classroom in Kansas City, and this young man, Mexican-American, and this Black woman were talking about the impact. There was just a shooting the day before, and they come into class, and they are in tears, devastated. And they asked their principal, you know, a white woman, can we have space to talk about this? And she said yes. And the gratitude they felt that, like, they got permission to do that, that somehow it was a privilege to be able to bring that. And then it was awesome to watch the teachers really understand their role in that and how they had to help kids process that. That's just real stuff. And yet it gets externalized as social justice or, I don't know, something that's separate from what our kids are facing every day.
Got a question over here in the corner.
Hi, my name is Tanya Clayhouse. I'm currently consulting, formerly with the Department of Education. I had a question. Actually, first, I wanted to go back to a couple of comments that were made, particularly around Brown v. Board of Education. I wanted to just clarify, I think that Brown v. Board of Education actually was more about resource equity and ensuring that those children who were segregated in a particular school system were afforded the same resources as other children, as white children who were at other schools. And so if we use that as the basis for when we talk about integration, if we talk about racial equity, I think that's how we've got to start this context, this discussion. And if we're going to talk about delivery systems, I wanted to ask, as you continue this discussion about how it is that we ensure that we have educational equity for all of our children, what is the conversation? How are you all contributing to the difference, to the challenges that are faced within the states, the delivery systems in the states, the tax-based system that is contributing to the differences of resource equity that exists within our state systems? We know that the federal system only provides a minimal amount of resources to our schools, but it's the states that are determining exactly how those resources are allocated. So it seems to me that that is a particularly a concern that needs to be addressed, and I'd like to hear more about that in the context of understanding how it is we're going to ensure this type of educational equity in our systems for all children in the context of ensuring educational justice.
And Tanya was actually a member of a panel for a discussion we had here at Brown v. Board, so good to be see you again. And I'm going to open it up to you. In fact, we've got about 5 minutes, so we've got some time to address this before we move to the next panel.
I mean, what I would say is, well, at Teach for America, we don't run around, you know, taking positions on this, but we run around grounding our teachers on understanding that, as understanding the complexity of inequity. You have to understand how the system is playing out in order to then figure out what kind of solutions you think are necessary. And so this is where the conversation of, yes, your job is first and foremost that we make a promise to children, which is to deliver on a great education. But as you're processing all the challenges that our kids and communities are up against, you have to understand issues like that in order to then be a productive and responsible part of contributing to the solution.
Yeah, I mean, I would say, if I understood what you just said, I mean, you also know that there was a debate within the black community about Brown, because there was a group of lawyers who essentially said, I'm good with Plessy if we can make it equal. And so your point is that the decision ultimately was you can't make it equal in America using Plessy, you know, as the way to do it. And so it was about resources, but for other people it was also about race, about the importance of black and white kids sitting together in classrooms. For some people that was because they felt if my kid can sit with this white kid, I'm gonna get what we need because the white kid's gonna have it. But so I mean, we can talk about that. But let me just say that I think any of us who care about our children are going to have to fight in the states, which I actually worry about. I was not a big, I'm glad ESSA passed, because to me it was another idea of states' rights that has never worked real well for black people. And so now what we're going to have to figure out is how to fight certain battles at the state level, but the funding thing was always being fought at the state level. But what I worry about, and I'm going to, I worry about what's going to happen to Title, you know, like what's going to happen to Title I, what is going to happen to those federal funds that do have an impact ultimately on poor kids at the state level. Even if we fight to increase funding at the state level, we're still going to have to fight to make sure that whatever federal funding that used to be there for poor kids does not disappear. So I mean, that's a battle that I'm really worried about from the funding standpoint.
Nina, Robert?
This is the second time I'm going to answer the question that I wish had been asked. When I'm not at Fordham, I'm attached to a charter school in New York City, Democracy Prep, where I teach the senior seminar in civics and citizenship. And I'm intrigued as I'm listening to this question, because one of the things I do in that class, I'm not teaching it this year, but I'll be back to it next year, is we try to put these questions in front of students. And I wonder if, at the risk of diverting the conversation, if that's something else we're not missing in this movement. We talk college and career. We never talk about what I like to call the third C, which is citizenship. Our students are not leaving us. Not only are they ill-prepared academically, they're ill-prepared as citizens. I would love to put these kinds of issues in front of high school seniors to say, this is the reality of your school. What are you going to do about it? And by the way, here's the levers and here's how to pull them. That's a critical component of a public education, regardless of where it occurs, that we're just absolutely blithe about right now.
So let's close with just a hopeful note. No, this has been hopeful, but a hopeful note. That was very clear. Take us out. We'll start with you, Nina, and work our way over. What keeps you hopeful? And try to do it in like a sentence.
Well, I have a lot to be hopeful about. Again, our movement with 3 million students in charter schools every day, and in our inner city settings, these students are knocking it out of the park. Every study done on charter schools demonstrates that they're doing well academically, that they're graduating, going to college, and many of our charter school leaders are also now working on making sure these students graduate college. Okay. So there's a lot to be hopeful about, but I do think you need to double down on investments around replicating these models, making sure that you are scaling excellence, and to the extent you're interested about equity, funding equity, social justice, and whatnot, to turn a blind eye to this kind of success is a real injustice, and I hope that the next administration, folks at the state level, really focus on that and make sure that they are putting their investments in the right places.
Okay, I'm actually getting the signal in the back.
Sorry.
Okay.
What I'm hopeful about is this room. It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon on a Wednesday, and we're all here talking about this. As long as that continues, we'll be okay.
What I'm hopeful about is that I know that if our kids are given the tools that they deserve, they can do great things.
I am hopeful that we have learned a lot in 26 years, and we have such committed, incredible people like the people in this room, and I hope that being uncomfortable in the maturity of our work doesn't drive people away, but instead that we lean into it.
And I remain hopeful because we have leaders like this from diverse perspectives focused on one thing, making sure the students learn. So with that, let's give our panelists a round of applause. We're going to take a break, and then we'll have the second set of panelists come, and I think Rick's going to introduce them as well. Thank you.
If folks, all right, if folks will go ahead and migrate back to their seats, please. All righty, folks, we'll go ahead and take their seats, please. We're going to go ahead and get started. All right, folks, we'll go ahead and take their seats, please. We're going to go ahead and get started. What we didn't tell you was that that first panel was kind of the sedate, mellow one. Now we're going to light things up a little. What we're going to do is now we're going to switch gears a little bit. And one of the things all the folks who you've had the chance to visit with so far in this coming session are among some of the folks that were able to join us for about the first 6 hours of the day to talk about these questions. And part of that conversation was what can we do going forward? How do we do better going forward tackling these issues? And that's really going to be the focal point of this next conversation. And to moderate it, I could think of nobody better than somebody for whom I have enormous respect and am privileged to regard as a good friend, Stacy Childress, CEO of the New Schools Venture Fund.
Thank you, Rick. Hi, everybody. Good afternoon. As Rick said, we're going to kind of build on the last conversation, the public panel, but also on a conversation that went on across the hall in a smaller room of about 22 or 24 education leaders from around the country talking about these issues together and also talking about the ways in which we talk about these issues. That seems a little meta, but that was a part of what we talked about this morning and early this afternoon that we wanted to kind of reflect out loud together with you about. And so that's our charge this afternoon. We're still, for those of you streaming, by the way, we're still using the Slido app. I've got it here ready to go, and so I'll be watching for your questions when the time is right on that. So before we dive in, I'm actually going to let each of the panelists introduce themselves. Name and what organization you work in every day. Yes, Andy, you start.
Hi, everyone. I'm Andy Smerick. I'm a resident fellow here in AEI.
I'm Chris Stewart. I'm the director of external affairs with Education Post.
Hello, I'm Marilyn Rames. I'm an education blogger. I blog for Education Post, Education Week, and others. And I'm also the founder and president of Teachers Who Pray.
And good afternoon. I'm Jason Cry. I'm the executive director of Hispanics for School Choice, which is based in Milwaukee.
And I'm Darrell Bradford. I'm the executive director at NICAN, which is the 50CAN branch in New York. I'm the executive vice president at 50CAN, which is based here in DC. And I'm also an education blogger for the 74, and I'm a fellow at the Thomas B. Fordham Institute.
Great, so a great panel. Has been an interesting and engaging discussion before we joined you here in this larger room. And so basically the conversation we had this morning, we organized around a set of questions that basically at the heart of it was, as we heard on the panel before, to behave as if we can just simply not discuss and not address issues of race, social justice, and school reform at all as we do the work that we do, whether we're in the moment we're in now with a shift in political context or the last couple of decades that we've been doing the work, the proposition that we can just avoid it altogether as we get about the business of doing the work is not operative. We're already talking about these issues, sometimes in small rooms, sometimes in big rooms, sometimes we agree, sometimes we disagree. And we think our charge, all of us as education leaders, is to find ways to stay in dialogue with each other across differences. Sometimes we're still going to disagree and disagree violently, but when we do disagree, can we do it in such a way that keeps the door open for the potential of working together on things where we do have common ground in the future rather than permanently alienating potential allies for future battles? And so that was the context of our conversation this morning. So I wanted to ask these folks to give you a little bit of a glimpse into that conversation, but from their perspective. And guys, feel free to tie back to the panel before us at any time you think that's relevant. So the opening question that I'll ask, and I'm only going to ask a couple of questions before turning to you, but the opening question that I'll ask that I'd love for each of you to address is, what was one thing you heard today from another colleague or a number of colleagues that helped you have a clearer understanding of a perspective that's distinctively different from yours? So something that you heard either as a theme or something that someone talked about that actually made you say, huh, that's interesting, think a little more about it, and had a deeper understanding of something that's actually, the point of view is different than yours, you might still disagree, but you understand it better. So Andy got a lot of head shaking down there, so I think you had some of those moments today.
Well, the big one is the accumulation of all those moments, and it struck me that this is such a sensitive issue that we all have a tendency to want to surround ourselves who make ourselves feel safe about the views that we have, which is completely reasonable. It's rational. Like, this is a tough issue. We want to be in an organization that has an esprit de corps, where we all feel like we have one another's back. The problem is, on an issue like this, is it can start to be an echo chamber within our organizations, where we're only talking to people like us who think the exact same things as us. And then it turns out that there's some good research on this, that actually makes you more homogenous in your hiring, in the way you talk about issues. And so my big epiphany of all this is we need to do a much better job of talking to one another and actually hiring people for our organizations who have different views on some of these issues. So I'm increasingly thinking, let's look at the leadership teams of some of these organizations working in this stuff, and if everyone votes the exact same way or would answer a 10-question questionnaire the exact same way, that's probably not all that healthy, and we're going to continue to butt into each other. There needs to be much more cross-pollinization, I think.
Yeah, we can either go down the line or you all can just hop in out of order is totally fine.
So I'm fairly certain we're not all voting the same way, as an observation. But every day I go to bed I go to bed at night and I wake up in the morning thinking about America's 8 million black children and 13 million Latino children who are walking into American public schools that I don't think are ready for them, are not prepared for them, and are not actually helping them reach their highest potential. That's why I come into this thing that we call education reform. But I realize that there's a lot of other people that come to the table who share some of the same aims about changing education, who may not be doing it for the same reason. So a lot of times you feel like you're the marginalized person, no matter who you are. And what I heard today was marginalization across the board. There are a lot of different people. We like to talk about education reform as a movement, and what I said today was I think it's a loose confederation of lots of people and groups involved in activities towards something. Loosely same goals.
It's not very catchy.
It's not a good t-shirt. It is not the best t-shirt ever. I would just tell you that much.
Hashtag.
Very poorly constructed for marketing. But marginalization across the board is the thing that I heard out in different people's voices. And in some cases, it was surprising. It was from folks who are conservative and feel like they're being marginalized, and folks who are liberal and feel like they're being marginalized, but all working towards the same aims. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I would just throw one thing out there, which is what surprised me is that I think there's a tremendous amount of fluidity left in where people can actually come down on this. You normally put people in a room who've been sort of disagreeing about something for a while, and the conversation is pretty sclerotic. And I feel like we're at a place now where whether or not we want to, we kind of have to reevaluate not just what our positions have been or like what our motivations have been. The question of motivation is a really important one, but also like what things can bring us together moving forward that actually help us solve political problems without alienating some of the key, particularly like the equity motivations that brought a lot of us here. So I was sort of heartened, if not left with much to do at the end. And I just, your sock game is good. I just want to give it to the people in the front row. Good man.
Yeah, I don't know if we can get the camera on the socks that were just called out, but they are pretty spectacular.
It's a thing. It's a thing.
It's a thing. Yeah.
Just thinking about when you're in a coalition or you're part of a quote-unquote movement, which we'll probably talk about a little bit in this panel, generally you have the same goal in mind, at least. And this conversation this morning just illuminated the fact that, like, some of us are solving different problems. Like, we're not all solving the same problem. And therefore, our solutions sometimes clash, but they're somewhat similar. And so I'm hopeful that at some point we can define the problem very clearly so that we can come up with solutions by which we've all, like, collectively contributed to. So if education reform, in my eyes, coming in was equity, education equity for Black and brown children in the inner city. That's has always been my position. But I'm walking out with people who claim to be reformers, small r, who say, no, that's really not the goal. Like, that, if that happens, that's fine. I'm looking to help education in general, all children, the white rural children, as well as the suburban middle class children. So now it's like that education reform is just evolving bigger sets of the people that, you know, you're trying to help. So it's interesting.
Yeah, and before I forget, I want to say that I want to say hi to my wife and kids who are live streaming this right now back home in Milwaukee. Yeah. So hi, guys.
Know your audience.
He wins.
And, you know, one of my big takeaways is that despite the fact that, you know, we kind of call this a loose confederation, I mean, there's a lot of energy here. Like, look around this room, and there's a lot of energy in the room. And despite the fact that we approach issues of race, I mean, so I work for an organization that is geared towards the Hispanic community. How I approach that community's concerns is going to be a little bit different than someone who's working primarily with African Americans or primarily with the white community. But despite that, and despite how we define social justice, there's a lot of energy to find the common ground where we can work to help education for all kids. And so despite the fact that we focused a lot today in this event, kind of it seems like everyone's disagreeing about all these things, actually, the reason that we focus on it is because we agree on so much, which is fixing education and giving every family a choice.
One of the things I'd love to follow up coming out of that kind of good set of, kind of takeaways from the morning, one of the things that struck me that I'd love to hear you guys reflect on a little bit is something that I've known, and I think we all probably intellectually know, but to see it really alive in the room was both energizing and a learning experience today. Sometimes we talk about our differences as we're doing school reform work, let's just stay within that for now, as conservatives and progressives, white and Black and Latino or Hispanic ed reformers, and kind of have these categories that we place people in, and that often being put into one category leads us to assume a lot of other things about each other, about politics, about motivation, why we do the work, and the, you know, multitude of intersections that people have across those, I think was a really interesting and some of the powerful discussion this morning is kind of noticing that and encouraging each other to be careful about that. So any kind of reflections on that from you guys? Darrell?
So I would actually, it's funny, I would describe that as a benefit of being in the loose confabulation. Because I've just made up another word. When I first got into ed reform, I like Robert in a previous life worked in the magazine industry, but I had sort of two mentors, like one who was like a sort of a free market Republican and one who was a social justice sort of a Democrat that had two times been the chairperson of Citizens for Carter. And like I was like the Charlie Sheen character in Platoon in this thing, you know? And they just taught me. They taught me so much about the world. And I really came to value like the things they disagreed on. Because we were all like sort of completely aligned on, you know, choice. That was what we were kind of grounded in, and equity issues. That's what we were working on. And so now, like I find like the labels You're a liberal, you're a conservative, you're a progressive, you're a Democrat, you're a Republican, like so imprecise to describe like what I feel like is the orientation that a thoughtful citizen who takes good policy and runs with it should have. And I don't think I would be this way if I didn't have the opportunity to sort of like, you know, talk to Andy or talk to Rick or talk to Chris or Marilyn, and both of whom I consider kind of North Stars on this stuff. So the pluralism of it, to borrow from the title of Ashley Berner's book in the front row, I think is both like sort of like necessarily confusing because lots of people have different orientations, but it is also, I think, probably one of the best things about the movement, confab, get together, school reform party.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You never really know someone until you walk a mile in his or her shoes, and it's so easy to make guesses about someone's background, their motivations, their philosophy, and then you hear their stories. And this is part of my opening statement about the need to just have conversations with folks. I mean, this Will Rogers line of, I hope I don't mangle this, I've never met a man I didn't like. I mean, once you get to know someone and know their story, all of a sudden it's much harder to parody them, to caricature them, and they're no longer just a category. They're a person in full. And then you may still disagree, but you, at least I say, I have a whole lot more appreciation and much more humility about my own views after getting to know them.
Right, and I just add really quickly that, I mean, I think that also when you do this work, when you're an agent of change, you know you're doing a good job when you're uncomfortable, when people are uncomfortable, when one day, you know, however you describe, you know, a progressive is calling you mad at you, the next day, however you describe a conservative, they're calling you mad at you. And for me, that's kind of my, you know, how I gauge like the barometer for how well I'm doing what I do every day. Because I try to stay focused on families, and that's gonna get you in a lot of trouble from a lot of people, depending on which way the wind's blowing.
Mm-hmm. And by that marker, I'm very successful. Yeah. That's true. That's true. Like, I rule this thing. That's the marker. Like people being mad at you. You know, I can tell you the day that I got into education reform. It was December 16th, 1990. That was the day that I like held for the first time my oldest, my firstborn. It hit me at that point that this was the most beautiful moment in my life, and it was also the most scary. I looked at him and I thought to myself, I am not gonna be able to do for you what a lot of people are doing for their kids. I had had a lousy education, I was working in the service industry. I'm looking down at the most beautiful thing I've ever seen, and at the same time, my heart was breaking on the inside because there was this deep abiding fear that I was gonna mess this up. I remember putting him in a school in kindergarten, and the day that I walked away from the kindergarten, I remember thinking to myself, man, this is gonna be a journey, this is gonna be a trip. I'm probably gonna mess this up, this probably is not gonna work out well. It went fine until about sixth grade. Sixth grade is when we had to make some really tough choices because everybody around me, including teachers in my district, were telling me that they would not send their own children to the school he was assigned to. Mm-hmm. And so we had to make some choices. We had to make some differences, and that really started me on my self-education process. Fast forward, when he goes to college, I remember the day that I dropped him off to college exhaling for the first time in like 12 years, and I was a hot mess driving home, right? Just crying, ugly cry, you know? Just like, seriously ugly cry. And then the next time I cried like that again was 4 years later when he actually graduated from when I was there, and the college that promised me that he would graduate in 4 years actually did it. And I drove away from that day thinking, man, I remember kindergarten. I don't know politically what you call that. I don't know if that's conservative or progressive or Democrat or Republican or whatever. It's the reason I show up to this game to say that there's somebody else just like me sitting somewhere in a city who's feeling the desperation and the heartbreak that I felt, that I know I'm intimate with it. Men don't talk this way about their stories, but that is neither Republican nor Democrat. That's neither liberal or progressive. And that's my story about like these ideas that we have about people. As long as you're helping me get that choice, yeah, that situation, right. that to fix my problem, I don't care where you come from, to be very honest with you.
And your story goes back to who you are and what your life is like, mm-hmm. and what you know, if you're experiencing that, what other families who have even less resources than you are experiencing. And I brought this out in the group to be motivated by that, not by the politics, not by what can, how can I profit or get this better position or getting good with so-and-so, but going back to what do kids need and focusing on that. And when you have children, it's so much more pronounced because kids keep you honest. You can say a lot of things about what should be done in this world, and but then if you apply it to your own child, then you know you have to like put your money where your mouth is, where your child is. And so for me, being driven by that keeps me honest, keeps me consistent, no matter who's in office, who's our president, who's our governor, being honest about what needs to happen for my child and my neighbor's child. Just, I think it's something that we talked about being an asset to us going forward in this work.
Yeah, and I wanna ask you guys that. I mean, just you know, a little more context. This, like, it sounds like we're all getting along great, and I think we are, and that's good. But we're not going
it's a
to
lie.
Always.
It's a facade.
We're on the best behavior. There, you know, there is real acknowledgement in our discussion this morning. You know, somewhat reflected in some of the you know hard tensions in the first panel, that across various categories we are still going to have different. Goals that we're seeking, different hypotheses or theories about how to reach those goals, and therefore different strategies, different tactics. But there are going to be plenty of times when there are things we also want to work on together, even through all of those differences, and that, as I said a few minutes ago, sometimes the way in which we behave towards each other when we differ can influence whether or not we're really going to be able to work to those work on those things that we might have common ground on. So we talked some about that this morning with some very specific examples of ways in the last, say, 7 or 8 months, we may not have all lived up to our highest aspirations for ourselves or for each other on social media and through blogs and in other kinds of forum. And so one of the things we talked a lot about that this morning, and I'd love to hear from each of you. You know, what's, let's start with what's one thing that you kind of come out of the conversation earlier today being committed to in terms of your own behavior, your own kind of presence in the field, your own engagement with disagreement and those who those with whom you might differ.
Well, I mean, for me, and earlier today, there's a Spanish saying, gato con guantes no caza ratones, which means that, you know, a cat wearing gloves isn't going to catch any mice, which means basically to get something done, you've got to get your hands dirty, right, to accomplish it. And so for me, you know, there are those of us in the last panel talked about it a little bit who says, oh, well, I'm only for charters, or I don't know about vouchers, or online learning, well, is that accountable? We can work out all of that. And what we need to do is just commit to the fundamental principle, which is that you know a lot of kids in this country that aren't getting the education that they should be getting. And they need the power to make a choice that's going to work for their families. I know a woman in Milwaukee named Saida. She moved to Milwaukee from Chicago. She has a child in a Catholic school. She has a child in a bilingual public school. She has a child in a Lutheran school that has a STEM program. Hmm. You know, when I meet people like that,
wow.
I see success. And so, again, I want to commit to finding ways, putting all these other things aside and saying, let's put power back in the hands of parents and find the overlaps that are there. Because besides all the differences, I mean, there are a lot of overlaps there.
I think I'm not exactly sure if I'm answering the question.
I forgot the question too.
Yeah, you just know.
I'll answer whatever you want. I got another one.
I think, and I shared this earlier, that education reform as we know it is centered in inner city schools, black and brown schools. Maybe that wasn't the original plan, and some people have expressed in the beginning they wanted to reform education in general for everybody, which I think is a laudable idea. But the way it looks now looks very black, it looks very brown, and it looks very poor in terms of who's being served. However, the leadership that's making the decisions across the board look very white. And the teachers in a lot of these charter schools also look very white. And the families that are being served in many of these charter schools aren't necessarily a part of the decision making. They aren't, at least in Chicago, I can say that it's very top down, very kind of colonial, for the lack of a better word. And so, like, when you have these kind of dynamics happening, the issue of race has to come up. The issue of social justice has to come up because the optics alone, let alone like just the influence that is needed to make sustainable change from the ground up, is not really present. And so for me, beating the drum of like, you know, even all the way up to like the philanthropic level where you're nonprofit, ED, you're trying to raise money for your organization, are those dollars gonna flow to you as a black and brown person as fast as they would flow to someone else who is not black and brown? So to put it this straight, if we are going to liberate children of color, then we also have to reflect that mentality to the adults and the people doing the work. So in other words, as a black woman, I shouldn't feel oppressed in my environment in the reform movement if my job is to liberate the community. Can I get an amen? Yeah. So that is an undercurrent that is flowing, and it's not always easy to discuss. But because we have this forum, I'm just putting it out there. And I try to blog about it where I can, just to say, like, the amount. And I think, you know, there are people who have tried to get at this issue in very creative ways. But just to put it very straight, like, oftentimes I kind of wonder, you know, are we reproducing my adult experience in the schools, or are we really changing the trajectory of the lives? In other words, at the school where I work with, there are no black teachers in the building, and all the black faces mostly work in the kitchen. I want to know, the black children that go there and they grow up and they go on to become teachers, will that school employ them? So it's a cycle. It's a cycle. Like, life is a cycle. These kids are going to grow up and they cannot afford to face the same racism and ceilings that we're trying to bust out in the schools. Like, that whole mentality has to keep rising through all levels of life. I don't want to keep talking, taking up time, but I just wanted to put that out there. Maybe we can talk about that.
I have what I think might be the sort of opposite side of that. So we talked about it today, but I know the thing that I've been trying to live with is the sacrifices or perpetual discomfort of being a person who is not in power, who has to navigate power to get it. And I want to sort of just frame it kind of bluntly. You know, we got this new person in the White House, and there are, in case you did not know, and there might be opportunities to work on policy there. Not tons of policy, but some policy. And some people are like, hell no. And I'm kind of like, did you poll everybody and find out whether or not this was a hell no? Like, did you ask the million parents on a charter school waiting list whether or not they wanted us to do this, like, or to not do this? Like, who, you know, when did you make that decision? And you know, I opposed the president when he was running for office. But I'm sitting there now, and I'm like, you know, if you were waiting for like the, if you were a person of color, or you were a person who was trying to acquire power, and you were waiting for a perfect framework and a perfect social framework, perfect political framework, ideal metaphysical moral conditions, and the perfect person in charge to give you power, your ass gonna be waiting forever. And so I'm like, I'm very, you know, like I'm glad this elicited a laugh, because it gets a lot of crying from me, because this is like, it's a very serious question about how much comfort you're willing to, discomfort you're willing to have, or comfort you're willing to sacrifice to make your people free, right? Or to make your point in policy. And I just think, I don't know if some of us have had to really like live with that in the way that is as pronounced as it is right now at this moment. And I mean, I think I'm sort of committed to doing it. I've been thinking about it a lot. I haven't really talked about it a lot, but I think the cost of doing it is like gonna be new to a lot of people who work in reform, because like we've had a good run to this point, and like we haven't had to pay like a huge sort of moral price to actually make public policy change. And it feels like there might be a price to pay now, which is gonna be less than people who got crosses burned on their lawns and who were lynched or attacked for trying to make us free was, but will be a price to pay nonetheless.
So this is a part where, you know, I think whatever ed reform is needs to be realistic about people's lives. Education for me is one of the most important things that we fight for, because I believe there's never been a revolution based on illiteracy. So the idea that you would have as many numerate literate people from marginalized communities is to me a strategy for lifting people out of their conditions. However, education is one of many issues. And poor people have been catching hell even over this last 8 years, where we were all compliant and happy with the president that we had then. Right. If poor people were catching hell then, I think we should be realistic about the fact that they are staring down some things right now that are deeply concerning. Education is one of them. But sometimes education reformers are like having the worst date ever. They just want to talk about themselves constantly. So you tell them all your problems, and they're like, you know what would cure that? A charter school. and you say, but my foot hurts. And they say, you know what's good for feet? Charter schools. Right? That's like the worst date ever, because it's like ed reformers continually have this personality disorder where they say, enough about you, let's talk about me. Right? Communities are experiencing a range of things. So to compartmentalize education is like one thing, and I can't talk to you about any of that other stuff, but I can talk to you about a good school, or, you know, wouldn't you be great for great schools? Well, any responsible parent should say, yes, you know, I want a good education for my child. Any responsible person talking to that parent should understand they got 15 other things, though, that are contributing to their marginalization, and education reform has not been very good about understanding the context in which they put schools, the context in which they teach and they put teachers into. And sometimes communities are kicking out so-called good schools like a bad kidney, because you're transplanting something, you're putting something that seems artificial into a place. So I just want us to be real about that. If there's any resistance to working, for instance, with a new political regime, it's not all invalid resistance.
Just one quick thought that came out of the meeting today is that, especially for those of us who write or talk for a living, we got to figure out how to strike this balance. And I don't have the right answer by any means, but so this might be cathartic. I'm going to share my pain with all of you. Maybe you can solve it. Which is, I have a 6-year-old and 4-year-old twins, and I like very consciously kept them away from the television for the past 12 months because I didn't want them to see the toxicity of our public debate. Mm. So I'm very mindful in my own writing, constantly trying my best to show decency, to not replicate what we saw publicly, because I have kids that I care about, and you know, we care about, you know, a civil society. So on one hand, we have to be mannerful, we have to be respectful, we have to recognize that, you know, pluralism demands certain things of us. But on the other side of this, I mean, Dr. Fuller often quotes Frederick Douglass on this, and this is absolutely true. I mean, power concedes nothing without a demand. And if we're constantly telling people to use their inside voices and not to yell too much or not to write too tough, we're gonna have a pleasant conversation that doesn't go all really any place. And so I'm trying to find this middle ground, and I hope we all are trying to do the same thing. How do we make sure that we show respect and disagree within certain parameters without telling people constantly, well, that's a little too much. I mean, big things happen when we're willing to break some eggs.
Yeah, one of the themes related to what Andy was just saying is, I'm not sure I'd call it a theme, but you know, something I know I'm gonna commit to and I heard other people toying with is we actually don't want to water down the debate, and we don't want to avoid our disagreements, because there's real power and magic in figuring out how to actually persist through those to better ideas and better solutions. And so it's the last thing any of us want to do. But there is something to when we do take up the pen to write or sit on a panel, to actually take on people's ideas and approaches rather than caricaturing them, yeah. You know, taking them on personally as a device to make your point. Or if you feel like you really do want to engage in that way before doing that publicly on a blog or through a Twitter, I'm not very sophisticated, Twitter stream or Twit storm or whatever those are called, before you're going to do a whole line of them.
Tweet storm.
Tweet storm.
Twit storm is when it's done poorly.
Twit storm is done poorly, okay. Tweet storm. That maybe we pick up the phone. Like, how about the old-fashioned way where we pick up the phone, have a conversation, hey, here's something that I saw go on over there that you're involved in that troubled me. I feel like I have to respond to it, either institutionally or personally. I want to talk to you about it to make sure I understand it and still know I'm going to be critical of it and the tweet storm's coming, but let's actually talk about it, at least if not face-to-face by phone first. And the more often we can actually be in actual dialogue with each other, interpersonally, and trying to understand each other's perspective and sharing with each other what our critique is and what we're likely going to do in public. We think that goes a long way. It's harder to be a jerk to someone you actually have a relationship with. Mm-hmm. It's not impossible. I do it often. But it is harder, especially in a professional context, to do that. And so more relationship building with each other, not just the small group of people in this room, but just in general, in the work we're all doing, taking opportunities to talk with each other, get to know each other when there isn't something to fight about, so that when there are those moments when we're clearly gonna disagree sometime, the ways in which we do it both honor who we are as individuals and uphold our dignity, but also allow us to be as sharp as we need to be and highlight where the really important disagreements are in our work. So that was something that we talked about this morning.
Can I give a very quick example of this to let you know that this happens and when it's done well, like the enormous benefits. I wrote something recently and two people who you guys, like you probably have read their stuff, were so upset about something that I wrote, they felt like immediately the need to respond. Both of them had the courage, the decency, the heart to contact me in advance and say, actually send me the draft of it. They sent me what they were going to write criticizing me to say, Andy, is this fair? And of course, at first I said, of course it's not fair, I'm always right, how dare you? But then they ended up, they published it and I'm smarter for it and the public debate is better for it, but I will trust them and I think they will trust me so much more in the future because we were willing to disagree agreeably, and I'm gonna try my best to model that in the future.
Same here. Jason.
I want to say one other part of it, I think, and kind of as a lone Hispanic voice on this panel, I mean, I just say that, when we talk about race, and we've talked about the history that African Americans have in this country, and we've mentioned colonial aspects to the system, Hispanics don't share that history. They have a different history. And a lot of the discussion about race that goes on in this country is about white and black and the tensions. And frankly, I think both sides make a lot of assumptions about what Hispanics may or may not think. I have a friend, who moved here when he was 15 from Cuba. And people ask him, oh, because they hear he's an accent. Oh, where are you from? And he's like, here. They mean, no, where are you from? He said, oh, well, I lived in Cuba for 15 years, then I came here to America, you know? And basically what he says is like, isn't American enough? Mm-hmm. And there is that, and I can't speak for all Latinos, but I mean, to that story's point, I mean, there are a lot of Latinos or Hispanics that don't even identify with those terms. I'm wearing a bracelet that says Panama, because if you ask me where I'm from, I say, well, my mother's Panamanian, or Cuban, or Puerto Rican, or Mexican. And so it's easy to kind of slip past that community. And what I'd say is that when we talk about ed reform and the Hispanic community, the people that I work with, they've come here to build a life for themselves. They're optimistic about their lives. And you know, something like Black Lives Matters, I mean, a lot of the folks that I work with, I mean, if they are Spanish dominant, they don't even know what it is. They're digesting news and things that, in a way that a lot, I mean, my coworker, she watches Mexican news every morning, not NBC, not CNN, not whatever. You know, I ask her and I say, hey, there's an accident coming down from where are you okay with that? She's like, what? Like, you know, I'm talking about what happened in like Chihuahua yesterday, you know? There's a foreign outlook to what Hispanics see. A lot of them don't understand. That same coworker, when her son was going to college, she's like, Jason, what is the FAFSA? You know, and she knows all kinds of things about choice, school choice, but it's just not her experience. The other part of it is language, is that they're not getting the information from people on this panel or in this room. And so we've got to think about ways to attack that community, because you'll know, I mean, from seeing the statistics, I mean, the community, almost every survey you see, 70% plus Hispanic support these issues. And so we need to find ways to give them credible information about those options so that they can join this fight and not just be kind of a hanger-on to a white or black narrative. And so when we talk about race, I think that's something that oftentimes is looked over.
Yeah, thank you for that, Jason. All right, I'm going to open it up to the floor for questions. Folks have questions for the panelists. You can raise your hand. We'll make sure a mic gets to you. When the mic gets there, if you'll give your name and affiliation, and then ask your question. I see a hand over here. Paige, you have the mic? Okay.
Thanks. My name is Bob Bilifiori. I'm from New York. I'm a communications and otherwise agitation consultant. So how do we, you know, we are in, maybe you agree, maybe you don't. Just a quick statement and a question. How do we keep these diverse opinions and perspectives on how we're approaching school reform from dividing us so that, for want of a better term, the bad guys who are universally, single-mindedly focused on killing us don't succeed?
I will just throw one word out there that I heard earlier today that I thought was really, really good, just maturity. And I say that because like there is a maturity to the single-minded approach of the bad guys, right? Because the institutions are older, the movement, confabulation, get together, hang out is older, and it is a central command thing. So it's easier to stay focused on a specific goal. Completely counterintuitively, we are utterly divided. You know, sort of on purpose, which is one of our greatest strengths, but also one of our biggest weaknesses. And we are young as a whole. Like, I would venture to say most of, like not most, but a lot of the people who work in education reform right now went to a very small group of colleges. I may have gone to one of them, and have only voted for one president, and they voted for that person twice, right? So they don't know what it is like to have to live in a difficult time and stay focused on a specific thing that makes you uncomfortable, but that is ultimately like valuable. So that sort of maturity, I would say, it's not just about age. I think it's also about disposition. Is something that is, I don't know if I want to say it's in short supply, but I do want to say it's something I think we need more of to get out of this spot we're in right now.
Thank you. Others on this? It's a great question.
It's a tough question. We're an incongruent group of people working on a similar issue. We're not a movement. And when you talk about the bad guys, you're talking about people who have been organizing in communities over a long period of time with a vested interest in the status quo, a vested interest in the mainline public district schools. And they've got a lot of experience. I don't know that I have any hope that we are going to replicate their unity of purpose. And I'm just being realistic when I say that. I would love to be profound and say I've got exactly the idea that could bring together all of us to counteract that. But they've got a great head start. They do have a single purpose. They are trying to protect something that they feel like is their mortgage, right? Like, I don't know how many school reformers go to sleep at night feeling like what somebody's proposing is going to ruin their mortgage, you know, or take away their Disney vacation. But everything we're talking about is actually like germane to
it's got a cost to it.
It has a cost to it. Somebody's going to pay it.
I think being excellent at what we do is the best way to, in my view, the bad guy is anybody who is working not in the interest of children, whether they're call themselves ed reformers or if they're in the union, or if they're the mayor of the city that controls the school district. Those are the bad guys. I try not to demonize people. I like to see what they're doing, what their work is. That's how you show me that you're the good guy, right? Because you're teaching my child, you're teaching my neighbor's child, and you're providing a service. So that's how I like to hold people accountable, is by what they produce. And there are plenty of charter schools, even in Chicago, that aren't producing quality instruction. There are plenty of neighborhood schools that are not producing quality instruction. So I don't prefer one over the other, quite frankly. I would really have liked to seen education reformers working within the school district to in critical mass to kind of change some things, because even if there is a great charter school availability and you get in through the lottery, if you have no transportation and there is no busing, at least where I am, unless you're like profoundly disabled, how are you going to get your child to the other side of town, this great charter school? When you have a neighborhood school that you can, your child has to go to because there's no way to get them to that better option. So I, you know, going back to whether you're left or you're right or you're Democrat or you're Republican, I don't accept any of those labels. I'm for what is right, and I'm for what is going to move this generation forward with quality options that are really truly options. Because you can't access them. So if you give me a check and you put my name on it, but I don't have a bank or I don't have any ID, I can't cash that check. So I'm just saying, like, for me, how do we fight the bad guy is by holding each other accountable, even in the movement when something's not right. At some point, someone has to, I would rather be corrected by Chris than the union person, sure, right? Because then they're gonna put me on blast. They're not interested in helping me get better. Yeah. So let's all try to help each other get better, and that way we justify our existence.
Mm-hmm. Great, other questions? We've got the mics, got some hands over here. Ian, either one's fine. I'll keep track of. Here we go.
Hi, I'm Lauren Dahl. I'm not an educator, but I've been paying attention to it more. I've become the director of a little operation called Museum of Teaching and Learning, and I'm from Southern California. And we're experiencing a big impact there that we haven't talked about all today. That is the Asian minority and the impact and changing of values about education and ways to deliver education. Would you comment?
Mm-hmm. How's that going in Minnesota?
Huh? How's it going in Minnesota? I think it's amazing that public education is 150 years old or older, and it's just now discovering that it has Asian people, or Hispanic people, or Latino people, or Mexicans, or whatnot. That should tell us something very seriously about the structure of this thing. That we're waking up in 2016 and saying, we've got Asian people, and by the way, they're not Asian people. We have Hmong, and we have Japanese, and we have Filipino, and we're like, right, you know. That tells me how behind the curve we are. I actually, to point to Minnesota, we have charter schools that have sprung out of communities. The Hmong community came to the school district, said, we are worried that our kids are gonna lose their language and they're gonna lose their heritage, and they started forming their own schools. Somali kids have done the same thing. We have some charter schools that have come out of the Latino community. We have some Afrocentric schools that have come out of the Afrocentric thinking people. And in each one of those cases, it was a response to the district, not the local districts, not having discovered the unique needs of different folks. So for me, if this is a district thing, I was on a school board, an urban school board. I actually don't know how you fix that. And you say you wish more of us worked within the system. I actually believe that school districts are hospice for good ideas. Like, that is where good ideas go to die, right? So I'm not one of the people who's like trying to figure out how we re-engineer. This is a difference in ed reform. Some of us are new schoolers. Like, right, I'm a new schooler. I actually have no, like, I never used to hear anybody talk about, no abolitionists ever talked about slavery reform. Because they knew that it's because they knew slavery was bad, right? But we talk about school reform as if these schools are good, right? And that just a few tweaks around the edges might make them better. And I don't believe that. I'm a new schooler. I believe in new schools. So when you talk to me about an Asian population, if you talk to me in terms of maybe can we set up a school that meets their unique cultural and heritage needs,
Asians are outperforming the
blacks. Some are.
I want to answer
that. The Hmong aren't, yeah. Right? So this is the thing about Asian. This is the thing about Asian is like it's a catch-all, just like Hispanic is, right? Like, you know, we talk about Hispanics, but are we talking about Florida Cubans or are we talking about California Mexicans, right? Because California Mexicans, as a school issue, are worried about their kids getting picked up from school bus stops by ICE, right? And getting deported, right? So we just have to be really careful about who we're talking about in these groups, and do we have an educational solution for them? Is the system capable of providing them with something that they need? And I'm not so sure that the district system is.
Can I add something on the other side of this too, though? So I wrote something about this a couple of years ago. So in New York City, we have a selective high school system, and there are like 9 schools, and the crown jewel of them, depending on who you talk to, is called Stuyvesant. And it is notable because basically no black kids or Hispanic kids get into it. I guess there are like 750 kids got in last year, and like 7 of them were black or Hispanic, and like 650 of them were Asian. So the answer to fixing this problem is not to increase the number of black and Hispanic kids who actually take the test to get in, not to explain the system better, not to intervene in the middle schools because like black and Hispanic kids disproportionately go to schools that aren't preparing them well for the test. And the test is hard, to be very clear. It is to attack the Asian kids who are actually playing by the rules, right? Who have like, we've set up this system, they're doing exactly what they're supposed to do, and the results look the way they're supposed to look. So it's kind of interesting to see that, like, as much as on the one hand, to Chris's point, there are all these other groups of Asians that are not served under like the model minority sort of dogma of like high performing Asians, we're blowing them up when they high perform to the other end. So it's kind of complicated across both sides, but that's like a unique thing that I don't necessarily think is happening with any other ethnic subgroup. Yeah.
But I just want to go back to Chris's point about the district. Charter schools, and I'm a proponent of charter schools. I worked at one, I sent my kids to one. I also worked in district schools before charter schools. They have the majority of our children, the district does. And if we want to like provide better education, like 5% I believe it's like no more than 10% of all the public school students in America are charters.
About
7%. Or 6%. It's low. So, I mean, we have we're trying to expand charters everywhere. Like, there are way, way more many districts that don't have charter schools than have charter schools. So if we're trying to scale reform for everybody, even minority children, they're mostly found in district schools. So to ignore that reality and to not see the fact that you actually have to get to a charter school, and for a lot of people, transportation is a big issue. I'm just making the case for those of us who are bold and courageous and work in the system, that there's a place for, I would hope, a reformer, lower R, to go in and try to shake some things up there too, because that goes back to the winners and the losers, right? And again, not all charter schools are high performing. So just throwing that out there.
Yeah, Andy.
Yeah, just one quick thought about this. Everything Marilyn said is correct, but it's also correct that almost 100% of kids in New Orleans are in charter schools, that over 50% of kids in Detroit are in charter schools, about 50% of kids in Washington, D.C. are in charter schools. Kansas City, it's probably around 40%. So we have seen over 25 years a system change going on here. And this goes back to Howard's point earlier, and I hope that this isn't too in the weeds, about the difference between public education, which is a set of principles, things that we believe in. It's like a creed. And then there's a delivery system, how you bring those things to life. The first one is like sacrosanct. You're never going to give up your principles. But the second one is man-made. Those things are fallible. You can change them. And so as we go from one system that made a whole lot of sense, the district, which is centralized and technocratic and be highly efficient, economies of scale, lots of good things about it. But in cities, as we're moving to this much more decentralized system that relies on parental choice, it relies on civil society, all of these issues that we've been talking about today get implicated in new ways. Mm. The way you think about race and deal with race and social justice and equity and transportation is very different in a system that was built 100 years ago, the district system, and one where things are decentralized and families have choice. So the issues are still on the table, but now we have to relitigate them and re-adjudicate them in this new system that's emerging more and more in America's cities. So this is just to say this problem isn't going away. It's going to have to come up in new and different ways in more and more cities.
Yeah. You so know, I want to split the difference that, between these two. I will say that, like, you've had centralization and decentralization, and then recentralization and then decentralization. New York has done that back and forth. Yeah. Chicago has had experiments with this local control versus, you know, appointed board and whatnot. All of them have failed and it succeeded at times. So we have to be kind of religious, agnostic about model, but religious about outcomes,
exactly.
Right? We have to look at the actual outcomes. Are Black people learning to read? Are they learning to count in ways that help them decode a very complicated society, right? And if we stick with the results and accountability for results, we can be model agnostic, right? I just happen to believe that I can make an educated bet who's going to win that the most of the time. But I'm not going to tell you who that is. I'm just going to say, let's just make it about results, and then whoever wins, wins, right?
So I was going to say, I want to acknowledge that a couple of the questions that have come in over Slido or exactly on this issue, so you guys got to it without specific questions about what about the traditional school districts. It sounds like everybody's talking about charters, so you guys got that point. And then the other version of the question was, where is the ideological balance? Where do we balance ideology with empirical research? Not all charter school work. Mm-hmm. Many of them do. Lots of them do for certain kids, but you know, on balance. And so I think having this conversation about outcomes, what we hold true, and what the benefits of decentralization and choices in the hands of families to make those choices is responsive to a couple of the questions that have come in here. I'm not sure they'd like your answers, but the questions did come in.
So I wanted to
acknowledge that. Right, they may let me know here on this nice iPad. So we had another question back here. Did we cover it already, okay, great.
Marilyn and Chris, hi, my name is Natasha, and I just like to point out that you're really onto something and pointing the conversation to connecting the dots to parents. who see the option but just can't make it happen. And so as we're sitting here, it would be so fascinating to hear more about unpacking those options and barriers so that, like you said, parents who find that they have a choice but can't afford busing, or how does a voucher work if you live in a tri-state area? And me as a parent wanting to make good on the choices out there and how that works. I think it also should make us think about this notion of social reform in a different way. What I find the conversation revolving around is fixing larger systems, but what we also have is that Harriet Tubman system of parents who are doing illegal things to make sure that their kids get access.
That's right.
What if some of that money was diverted to help connect mm-hmm. those dots so that parents could live in truth as they take advantage of those options? I'd like to hear you respond to that.
I don't know if you need to respond to it, right?
This is such a great point, though. Like, this is huge. I'll let you go first, and then I could just piggyback. I just take what you say, and I'll say ditto. Because I'm sure what you're going to say is going to sound really good and educated. So.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's so true. Like, you have the whole, like, I'm going to say I live at this address so that I can go to this school.
Black market.
You know, because people do what they have to do, what they feel they have to do for their children, and it's not good. It's almost like, okay, back in the day, back in the, I believe the 60s or 70s, when a woman, you know, a poor woman had a husband, and the husband wasn't working or whatever, and she had to say, no, I'm a single mom, mm-hmm. and he can't stay here. He can't have his clothes in the closet, because if he does and they come in, I can't get any public assistance. So you create these systems by which people feel like they have to cheat in order to get in, and it's not right. In the perfect world, and I get this from the E.D. Hirsch book that I just finished reading, Why Knowledge Matters, choice is a quality school across the street from you, right? In the perfect world. Because that way, you can that is a guarantee that you have options. But we don't live in that kind of society. And it goes really deep. Like, I'm in Chicago is a very political, very... I can't even use I can't even say how I feel about my city. I love my city. But there was a situation recently, and I blogged about it, where we had a chance, when we talk about integration, we had a chance to do something really great between an overcrowded, wealthy, white Asian school and a underperforming black school from the old Cabrini-Green project. Sure. And they did two studies saying that you can merge these schools and you wouldn't have these white kids in the hallways studying in classrooms. You'd have all this space. Then the school board, for the second time, punted on it and said, oh, we need to do more studies. While they closed 49 black, mostly black schools and merged them like in 2 months, 2 or 3 months. They just dropped it. So I think our leadership, I mean, and I know they don't want to tick off all the wealthy white people because some of them were upset. They were making a noise about, you know, will it be safe? Why are we doing this? We can come up with some more solutions. We need more time. And so I get it. You know, we want to keep the middle class white families in the district. But I think it all boils down to being courageous, making decisions based on what's in the best interest of children. And we know diversity, if it is a natural fit like this, is a positive thing. Actually, some studies say that white people benefit more from diversity than black people do. But we need our leadership, and this is what I was saying about like putting pressure on people who do have this kind of power in the district to say, do the right thing. Follow through and stop being political. We can make these things work. So I'm gonna hand it over to you.
I think we're long overdue for this to turn into parent-driven reform.
Yes.
Right, and it's the difference to me between sociology and anthropology. Sociology comes to you and tells you, I studied you. I know all about you. Let me tell you about you. Mm-hmm. Anthropology says, can I come live in the hut for a few days, maybe a month, take notes, go home and think about it and then come back and ask you some more questions about what was that thing you ate? What was that thing you said, right? You know,
powers of analysis.
Education really reform awesome. Needs to be more about anthropology now, moving yes. forward. It needs to be parent-driven reform. I've likened ed reformers to the Air Force. They fly over territories and they drop leaflets from the skies, like some vouchers and some like charter schools, and they drop them from the skies. And the opposition is right there on the ground to pick up the leaflets before the people even read them, first of all. Let's just say that's the first problem. The second problem is, like, New Orleans is the perfect example where we thought if we just give you better schools, you'll come to love us, yeah. right? You know, 5 years, 10 years, and no matter how we do it, no matter how we set it up, you're gonna love us at one point. But if you would have done anthropology, you would have seen the parents who were sitting, whose kids were coming home in the dark and going to school in the dark and having three different kids go three different directions, and how the enrollment system was just all jacked up, and parents were complaining. And they didn't have like an education problem, they had a Spirit Airlines problem, right? They just weren't listening to their customers, right? So I actually don't think that could survive much longer, right? Because now that's the pinnacle of the reform kind of example. And for that to have a customer service problem is more than I think any of us can handle.
Can I make one last point on this? So I also think it is always important to ask yourself, the things that we think are broken with the system, are they being produced because the system is broken or because it is working the way it is supposed to? Right. So like convenience and access are actually priced into the system via the housing market, right? And so that works on purpose. And that is particularly pernicious if you don't have, if you're the person that we've been talking about, if you're the mom or the dad or the kid that is not close to a good option, that is surrounded by bad ones, you know? So kind of to go back to Chris's, you know, point about being a new school guy, and kind of punting on Marilyn's point about where all the kids go, it is really important to understand it. If over time the same thing keeps happening, you do have to ask yourself whether or not it is working the way it is supposed to, and not merely just not benefiting from your intervention.
Mm-hmm. All right, we still have a question right here? Yes, okay. Thanks, Ian.
Hi, kind of a political question. We're looking for, in politics, message, mass, and also coalitions. Are there themes, are there venues? You mentioned in terms of Hispanics having kind of a different way that they're getting their information. If I'm white, I'm affluent, and I can send my kids someplace else, what kind of themes and messages and venues can we use to reach people to build these coalitions?
Why don't we ask the state board president what he thinks?
My answer is going to be terrible and inarticulate. And I mean, it's, as long as we have had school choice programs and decentralization, like, it inevitably ends up being a story of the state and the city, and their history and their culture and the local activists there. And I think sometimes we force too much trying to take one lesson from one place and another. And the story of Chicago is a different story than the story of Washington, D.C., and that's a different story than Philadelphia when it comes to the politics and the implementation of all of these different changes. All I can say is, eventually, bottom line, you need a group of, whether you call them stakeholders, people who have a vested interest. Their little boys and girls are in the system, and we can never lose sight of this. Every single day in America, millions of low-income kids are assigned to schools that are not working for them. And that's gonna happen again tomorrow. Those kids will go there. And eventually, in these cities, a group of policymakers or advocates or families rise up and say, we desperately need something different. And that takes lots of different forms. But whether you call this a market problem, a government failure, a social justice challenge, a civil rights ill, it's the same thing. Low-income boys and girls assigned to schools that are not working, and their parents desperately, desperately need some sort of power to change things, and that's why I'm in this business.
Great. So thank you for that. Rick, I think you're going to wrap us up. So as he's making his way, just closing thought, guys, just like a 20 to 30-second kind of final piece of wisdom, advice coming out of the private session, the two public panels we've had, the great questions from the audience over the last couple of hours, just like kind of final takeaway piece of wisdom for the group.
So two things. One is that I feel like Dave Bowman on this stage at the end of 2001. It's got that feel, you know. that was the first thing. The second thing is that it's like, I feel like this is probably really important. This too will pass, right? Like, there's always a moment where you're like, the guns are going off and things are exploding in the sky, and you're like, this is the worst moment ever. We will never get through this moment, and then we do, right? And the reason why we do that is because we're actually, you know, even though our motivations are different, in the main aligned around the right thing, which is that, you know, kids in America are never going to take, they're never going to be truly free or take their place among us as, like, full human beings if they're not well educated. And I think there are lots of people who actually have that at the center of what they do. And as long as that remains true, I'm very hopeful.
Great.
Hopeful.
Jason?
Yeah, and for me, and this kind of answers your question, sir, I think that it's a matter of just communicating. So parents need to talk to policy wonks. Reps need to go through schools. And we need to talk about these things so we can understand each other. And then I think that what we've talked about is that parents need more power. I mean, there's nothing more profound or more persuasive than a love a parent has for his child. So let's put the power there.
Marilyn?
Crossing political lines, ideological lines, making sure that you have a friend in your life that doesn't agree with you on everything, and bouncing that off of that person and bouncing your ideas off of them and them off of you will make you more well-rounded, more thoughtful in your analysis of what the problem is and how to solve it.
Great. Chris?
And in my life, that person's called a wife. So I just want to be really clear about that. Listen, we just went through a long season of political battles where education was at the margins of the discussion. And to me, that's a shame, because when I talk about the 8 million black children, the 13 million Latino children, the way more millions of poor children, America just will not be the country that we want it to be if we keep skirting the issue about 1,700 colleges of education that are turning out teachers that can't teach, the 14,000 school districts that have wildly different standards that parents don't understand, the states that are wanting to play games with the accountability systems and want to hide their failure beneath new schemes of data schemes that help them hide and erase the achievement gap by getting rid of the data, right? These are things that are monumentally important but absent from the public discussion. I think it's incumbent of all of us to bring this back to front and center so that we can at least talk about it in the public sphere.
Great. Andy?
Yeah, the longer I do this business, especially inside of government, the more I recognize that there really honestly are very few bad guys in this. There are people with very different principles, and they prioritize them differently, and they have different views of the good life. And we need to respect that, but that doesn't mean that we have to give up on our principles and our priorities, and I just want us to be happy warriors for this stuff about low-income families and choice and diversity and spreading power, and take the fight to them when necessary, but not everyone's a bad guy who disagrees with us.
Yeah, happy warriors. Thanks, guys. Let's give the panel a hand. Rick?
Thanks, folks.
You know, Andy, I like that. Your AEI is owed to Hubert Humphrey. That's excellent. I just wanted to thank all of you guys for joining us today. I wanted to thank both panelists, particularly Stacy and Gerard, for some exquisite moderation. When I teach this stuff, I always teach that about the most arrogant act I know of is to want to be involved in policy, because you're telling everybody else how they ought to live their lives. The only thing that comes close is education, where you're trying to tell everybody else's children how they ought to live. So this is tough stuff. These are areas where we're talking about things around which we have deep and profound differences in experience and in which we're going to disagree. But the thing that gives me hope is if we can have these disagreements in a way that's worthy of the charge that we have asked, the responsibility we have sought. People in this room want to be in charge of schools. They want to be making education policy. They want to be shaping other families' lives and how those kids come up. The very least I think we owe of ourselves is to model the kinds of citizenship and the model kinds of discourse that we want to raise our kids into. And I can't think of anybody who has done a better job of that in recent months than the 11 folks between the moderators and the panelists who have been good enough to join us today. Thank you guys so much. Hope all of you have a wonderful afternoon. We'll see you soon.